Hey, good morning. Wow, it is so good to be here. Thank you, Neil, for that really gracious invitation, Jamie, and just Pastor. Thank you. I'm so honored to be here. Really am. And I want to kind of say, I'm in a funny place this morning in a good way. Like, I feel so good about being here, and I feel so at ease with what I feel here. I just feel really relaxed and really want to, I don't know, if it's all right, take my time a little bit and just bear down. And you normally do? Yeah, great. That's the norm around here? That's good. That's good. I love that. I maybe want to start out by saying, and well, I'll do this first. Guys, I'm going to go to Luke 4, 16 through 25. So if there's any shot you get that up on the screen, that'd be great in a few minutes, but it'll take me a while to get there. I don't mean this as a way of like just visiting or whatever, and I don't want to give you platitudes. I don't want to seem like I'm not the guy who just shows up and wherever I am just tries to flatter people or whatever. And nor do I think I'm some big prophet or have extra special discernment or like whatever. But you know, it's very clear to me that what's happening here is really special. You know, sometimes I can go, and I say this without any judgment whatsoever, but I can go to big churches, I can go to vibrant churches, and just don't feel the presence that I do here. It doesn't mean they're not doing good work, of course. But like, it's just so interesting to me how when people walk in the Spirit, and a place is founded really on a gospel of grace and mercy, how palpable that is. Like, you can feel it in the air. You know, you can know it within minutes. And I came in this morning, and so quickly, I was like, wow, this is a really good place. This is a sacred space, you know? This is like, God meets with people here. That's so clear to me. And I partly want to say that because I just think, like, when you're around a church long enough and when you're kind of in the trenches, for any of us, you know, like, especially when we're just dealing with real life stuff, it's easy to forget how special that is. And clearly to me, this is a special place. The kind of emphasis here on the Holy Spirit and the power of the Spirit, and yet again, so much grace. And I'm looking at the word grace right back here. Oh, it feels so good. There's freedom here. There's just freedom here, you know? And I don't, you just don't get that everywhere. So I just want you to feel affirmed and encouraged that I believe in what you're doing. I know something of the kind of teaching that you get here, so I don't feel like I'm definitely not coming to like straighten anybody out or drop some massive. If anything, I'd only want to like just really encourage you in the direction that I feel confident that the church is already going in. Let's take just a moment to pray, if you don't mind. Lord, I just feel like I just feel like I'm breathing really pure air here right now, and I'm thankful for that. Your presence here is oxygen. Really, your Spirit is breath and life, and I feel you breathing into us and refreshing us, and we're just so grateful for that, God. We're grateful for the gift of your presence. We don't take that for granted. We don't take the gift of each other for granted. I just pray that in this time that we have here that you would now just open our eyes and our ears, not just to be taught, but that you would, in the words of the Apostle Paul, grant us a spirit of revelation, and that, Lord, there would just, you would reveal those things to us that really can't exactly be taught. You can show them to us. That I pray, Lord, to be things that you would show us, that you would give us eyes to be able to see, even as we're listening with our ears, that there would be eyes to be able to see things that we would not be able to see unless your Spirit breathes on us. We just want to be open and receptive. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everybody said, amen. Neil said a bit about my background, and I do have these really deep Pentecostal roots. I always say, half jokingly, I always call myself a hillbilly Pentecostal, and the reason I say that is because, I mean, my environment, where a few of the folks when I came in were teasing me about the, within the first 2 minutes, the way I say y'all and how often I say y'all, and it's kind of, I mean, these were just deep South churches, and my father is a minister, my grandfather was a minister, and I was really steeped in this tradition where a lot of emphasis on the power of the Spirit, lots of revivals and camp meetings and these really fervent kind of atmosphere, which were like wonderful and really, really wild too. I mean, they're really, really wild. It was kind of like a lot of things that I kind of grew up with looking back, services that now put me in mind in some ways, even though, and I would say this in a gentle, like loving way, but they were kind of like professional wrestling matches in some ways. I mean, literally, like, the night evangelists that would come through, a lot of them would actually have, like, finishing maneuvers. Like, you know, like, if you grew up on the WWF, Macho Man Randy Savage coming off the top rope with the flying elbow, or Hulk Hogan with the leg drop, or Ric Flair with the figure four. Like, everybody had, like, their own maneuver, you know? There was a speaker that I used to love, man, who would come in. He was pretty soft-spoken. Most of these guys would yell, but he was really soft-spoken, real gentle, and in his preaching. But then when it came time for the altar services to pray for people, like, that's when all the stuff happened. And his big deal was that he never laid hands on people. He would lay his Bible on people. But the thing in particular that he would do often is, like, he would actually throw his Bible out to people. And a true story, he would throw the Bible and he would say, "Receive the glory." And people would, like, catch the Bible, and bam, almost every time they would fall out. Like, he just, and that was like his finishing maneuvers. Like, this is what he does. That's the elbow off the top rope. So he catch right, bam, you know. And, like, all of these, there were a lot of things that were big and theatrical and wild. And, you know, admittedly, there was a lot of things that I loved and things I didn't know what to do with. There were often times where I kind of felt like people in the room were experiencing things that I wanted to experience, but I kind of felt like a little bit on the outside of it, always kind of like my face is pressed against the glass, wishing I could get in on that more than I actually did. I have an awful lot of services where I came down and would pray, and everybody else was praying and seemed to be tapped into something. I just wasn't feeling, and I would think there was something wrong with me. There was this one evangelist in particular who came through who, he was one of those guys, he laid hands on everybody, and it was always like, and whatever you think about this, again, people kind of falling out and that kind of thing. And I'm telling you, I was in his prayer line probably 100 times in my life and never fell out. And I was so upset about this because, like, it would look like a Civil War battlefield down around the altar, like bodies just stacked on top of each other. And I'm the one person still up with my hands raised, you know? So I assumed there was some kind of sin in my life. There's just something I didn't get, you know, like, whatever. All kinds of, like, frustration. And I think, like, you know, as I grew, I mean, my journey has taken me so many random kinds of places and churches, and had a year plus in an Episcopal church that became very dear to me, and incorporated different kinds of liturgy. Like, all that's been really, really good. But I'll say, like, at this point in my life, I'm surprised at how much I've kind of come full circle, and I'm really hungry for the Holy Spirit again. I'm really hungry for space, for God to move. Not to be hokey about it, or not to act like God is doing things in the room that he's not. Which part of the problem sometimes in those environments is that once you get to a certain point, it's like there's such an expectation that even if God's not doing anything, we're going to act like he is, because we sort of kind of need that to be the case. So not looking for that, but I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, and hence the song we sung this morning. I believe in miracles. I do believe in that. And there's a mystery to all that. I don't know why some people get healed and some people don't. Certainly don't think that when people don't, it's because there's something wrong with them or they don't really believe God, whatever. Disclaimer, 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 disclaimer. I still believe that the Holy Spirit wants to move and work. And I find myself saying these things these days when I talk about the Spirit, when I talk about a lot of things where I'm like, I don't know. I'm not that old of a man, but I did think about this the other day. Like, I've been preaching for 20 years. And I just find myself saying things now where I'm like, I can't believe I said that. That just doesn't sound like something I used to have said. Sounding more Pentecostal than I mean to, or maybe want to. Like, something, I can't believe I'm saying that. Now, you might get a little bit of that today where I'm like, anyway, this is an awful lot of setup. I wanted to go to Luke chapter 4, though. Clearly, again, I'm just having a good time. Luke chapter 4 is a wonderful text. This is the inauguration of the ministry of Jesus. And he'll quote here from the prophet Isaiah. I just want to share these words with you, share a few thoughts. We'll just kind of see where it goes. But Jesus, Luke 4, beginning with verse 16, says, Jesus went to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went to the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. I want you to really hear these words. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's the end of the quotation from Isaiah. Verse 20, then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.'" "And I tell you the truth," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. And we'll stop right there. I didn't even mean to read that far, but I'm glad I did. Jesus reads these words from the prophet Isaiah. The people are scandalized by this. One, because I think they rightly sense that Jesus seems to aggrandize himself. He understands himself to be the person being read about. Part of it is that this, what is supposed to be good news for them, comes kind of as a word of judgment, that the prophet's not received in his hometown. An example, so funny when you're preaching to, and he's, of course, ethnically and otherwise a Jewish man, but as he's saying this, he talks about how in the day when only Naaman the Syrian was the one who was healed, like, there's not some kind of special grace here that you know that you're the only ones who receive. It's the outsiders, and people are really upset about this. But I want, if we can go back to verse 18, I want to camp out here for just a bit, where Jesus is reading from the scroll, and first of all, he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor." Or many translations will say gospel, which means good news. To preach the gospel, to preach the good news to the poor. I really believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, in the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that the same presence, the same power that was at work in the book of Genesis, that brooding over the chaos, bringing order out of the disorder, bringing life and beauty, that same Spirit, the same Spirit that was at work in driving back the waters when the Israelites crossed over the Red Sea, that same Spirit is upon Jesus here. That same Spirit is upon the gospel that Jesus preaches, that anointing, that power. But Jesus says that, reading from the prophet Isaiah, that when the Spirit of the Lord is upon him, and I think this is so important, the Spirit has anointed Jesus to preach good news to the poor. And I honestly believe that part of what's happening kind of in the moment we're in with the church in North America, a church that does not preach a gospel that is good news to the poor will not walk in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. If the message of the proclamation of the church is not good news to the poor, it will not be anointed by God. Eventually, it will stop working. Eventually, you will not have signs and wonders and power. One of the things I always note about my own ancestors in the Pentecostal tradition, when you think about one-eyed William Seymour, son of a black slave, preaching in a glorified shack in 1906 in Los Angeles, and people of all ethnicities, 1906, 50 years before the Civil Rights Movement, and you have Latinos, and you have Asians, and you have blacks and whites worshiping in the same space. And the LA Times reported in the front page of the paper, "Weird babble of tongues has appeared in Los Angeles." Everybody was freaked out. But as they were experiencing signs and wonders and miracles, and the Holy Spirit was moving in this way, they were poor people, and they were preaching a gospel that was good news to the poor. It was empowering. Women were preaching in a time when women did not preach because they believed that whoever the Holy Spirit fell upon had authority and walked in that authority, and they honored that. There was space for that. Good news to the poor. It happened on the fringes of society. Within the tradition I come up in the Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee, these little revivals that happened in the mountains of Tennessee and North Carolina, lots of poor rural people who tapped into this kind of power. And the gospel that they were preaching, the gospel that they were converted under, was one that was good news to the poor. And I just really believe that when the gospel we proclaim is no longer good news for the poor, it's not a gospel for one where the power of the Holy Spirit is needed. If there's not poverty, if there's not need, you don't really need the Holy Spirit just for sort of garden variety like self-help. You know, that'll do what it does. You need power if it's going to be good news for the poor. And I would argue for a really kind of an inclusive reading of the word poor here. I would want to be clear that I certainly believe that throughout the scriptures, Old and New Testament, God, as some Catholic theologians would say, even has sort of a preferential option for the poor. Like God loves the poor as in economically poor. I do believe that throughout, we see that in Israel, we see that in the New Testament, the church, there's a special place at the table for those who are poor. We're called to especially care for the poor. But if you think about this text, you think about the Beatitudes in Matthew 5 and kind of throughout the teachings of Jesus. We've got, for example, in the Beatitudes, Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit. I think poor here is a broader term than just economically poor. I think it has to do with all kinds of poverty. I think it has to, all kinds of impoverishment. People who are in any and all kinds of need, emotional need and spiritual need, any and all kinds of distress. The gospel is only good news to people who are in distress. If you don't feel like you're in distress, if you don't feel like you're in need, then, you know, the gospel will not appeal to you. But I just really believe, especially like in these days, that there is an anointing of the Holy Spirit. There is going to be a power of the Holy Spirit that's available for those who will recapture the gospel as good news to the poor. And my own suspicion is that even though we have a lot of churches that may be technically successful, and I want to be very careful, again, not to pass judgment on anybody in particular, it's just not like that. But I just believe that when we stray far enough away from a gospel that's good news to the poor, if what we preach scapegoats the poor, if it blames the poor, if instead of empowering the poor, it exploits the poor in some way, at some point, the Holy Spirit just can't work in that and doesn't. You can have people still present, but not necessarily have a church. And if we want an authentic move of the Holy Spirit in our time, I'm just so convinced it's got to be a gospel that's good news for the poor. It has to be a gospel that brings freedom for prisoners, recovery of sight to the blind, freedom. Not more constraint, you know, not constriction, but freedom. A gospel that releases, a gospel that empowers. Let's read on just a little bit more. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Yeah. I'm kind of thinking that since like we're kind of in the same stream and a lot of us, I think, are kind of drinking from the same, this may not be new news to you, but this is actually one of my favorite moves that Jesus makes in the Gospels. Because if you read this text in Isaiah 61, Jesus is reading from the scroll of the prophet Isaiah verbatim, like everything, Spirit of the Lord is upon me, good news to the poor, all of this, these were the words of the prophet Isaiah. And so when Jesus is reading this, he's doing all that verbatim, and then you get to the end of this particular text, and if you read this in Isaiah, what it says is to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the vengeance of our God, the day of vengeance of our God. That's what Isaiah says. And it's so fascinating for me that when Jesus says to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, he rolls up the scroll and just sits down. This is like the ancient Middle Eastern version of the mic drop right here. Just roll up the scroll. Close the book. And I'm imagining that part of the offense of the crowd here, I don't think that's too speculative. You know, when you get to, if you come to a place in your life where you have a real revelation of the grace of God, the mercy of God, and that's what you teach and what you preach, the accusation you're always going to get, and I've certainly heard this in my life, is, well, I like what you're saying. That's fine. That's good. I'm okay with this good news to the poor. But you're leaving some stuff out. You left out part of the verse. What about, and then quote whatever the passage is on judgment or whatever. I'm so intrigued because I think Jesus knows what he's doing here. In his day, his Hebrew Bible did not have verse numbers to it, right? So like, kind of drunk monks added our verse numbers later. They're fine, they're helpful for categorization, but just so you know, there's no special anointing on the verse numbers. Like that comes much later. But you know, this isn't about. It's not that like it's part of the next verse or something. If you read Isaiah, it's part of the same sentence. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. Mid-sentence. So for a audience that has been schooled in the Torah, nobody is missing. It's not escaping their attention that Jesus doesn't say the whole thing. And I have to imagine this is part of the offense here. What about the rest of the text? That's the trouble with grace preachers. They're always leaving stuff out, right? That's the trouble. But he does. He leaves some stuff out. And in general, when Jesus, the way that Jesus preaches the Old Testament, over and over again, if you pay close attention, there are certain things he will leave out. There are other things that he will highlight that had not been highlighted before. The way that he interprets the Old Testament, very, very different. And I'm saying all of that to say this, ultimately. Not only is a gospel that is anointed by God and therefore a church that's going to be anointed and walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, got to be a church that preaches good news to the poor and preaches freedom and release, but it's going to have to be a people that preaches grace and mercy and acceptance and not condemnation. That's just not a gospel that God anoints. And I'm not saying anything profound right now. I'm very aware of this. But I really believe that ultimately when there's too much condemnation in the water, when there's too much judgment, which oftentimes in terms of motivation may even come from a really good place. And I see that. I know an awful lot of people who will say an awful lot of fairly terrible things, but they're motivated because they really believe that they're warning people in a way, you know, something they need to hear, that they're going to help them escape hell or like what. I understand motivation and all of that, but I really believe just to after a certain point, like, the Holy Spirit just can't work in a gospel that's based on condemnation or that's a glorified version of karma. What goes around comes around. If you do good, God will be good to you. I'm saying a lot of things this morning that I didn't intend to say, so it seems like I'm ambling. I'm having a little bit of fun, but I'll just tell you this. So, like, what, part of the pain of my story, and I don't have time to kind of go into all this. There's not what it's about. I've got good time? Okay, good. I keep forgetting that. You get, thank you for that, sincerely. I'm divorced, and that's still weird for me to say. I never would have imagined it, never in 1,000 years that I'd be divorced, especially coming from the context that I did. Nobody was divorced. And I sort of, all of my life, I didn't, I kind of was so on like the straight and narrow. I never had sort of a prodigal season in my life. Knew Jesus since when I was 5 years old. Always wanted to pursue the things of God. The idea of any of that was unthinkable to me. But so there's been certainly been some pain in my journey. A lot of things have happened. A lot of things have shifted and changed. A lot of ways that I feel like I've experienced the grace of God flat on my back in ways I would not have experienced before. But for our purposes right now, all that is kind of a setup to this. So I'm at a place in my life where kind of first time post-divorce that I'm dating. And I don't know when I've even said this anywhere. It's kind of like, it's still weird because I don't know how at 38 to talk about dating. It's so odd, but she's a wonderful person, and she loves Jesus, and there seems to be like a lot of grace on that. But I never had kids. Don't have any kids. She has 2 kids. She's also divorced, one 13, one 8, and her 8-year-old daughter is named Pepper. So it's a whole new thing for me, like learning about kids and like that. This has just not been part of my life before. So I love it. It's really, really wonderful. But I was just thinking about. We had kind of a funny deal a few months ago because it's Christmas, and Pepper, Nicole's daughter, is like, she's really into the Elf on the Shelf thing. Y'all know about the Elf on the Shelf? I didn't know about it. Like, I didn't know about the elf. I was not aware of this mythology. It's like you have a little elf who lives in the house, and he's watching everything that you're doing and, like, then reporting back to Santa whether or not you've been good. And the idea is, like, you know, you move the elf around in the middle of the night, put the elf in different places in the house. So, but the thing is, you can't touch the elf, or then the elf will lose its power. Then you have to put the elf in the freezer. This gets really... it's foggy for me, too. But the bottom line is that the elf is supposed to be the one that, like, reports whether or not you're being good. And Pepper's really into the Elf on the Shelf. Like, it's a whole, man, she's around holidays just consumed with it. So one day I was kind of in a good mood, kind of a teasing mode, and my sort of preacher way was kind of coming out. And I was like, Pepper, like, I want to talk to you about this whole Elf on the Shelf. Because, like, in addition to the Elf on the Shelf, you know, they also have a nativity out. And I was like, Pepper, I don't know if you're aware of this, but there is one greater than an elf on your shelf. I really did see this. And I said, you know, like, the thing about the elf, right, is, like, the elf, and I do it kind of teasily, but I use these words. I said, the elf is about what people call karma. The elf is like, if you're good, then God's going to be good to you. If you're bad, you're going to get punished. I was like, now, the one in the manger, Jesus, he said his Father makes the sun to shine and the rain to fall on the just and the unjust. Doesn't matter who you are, where you come from. God's posture is always good, always merciful. And I like, Pepper, like, I'm just saying, like, I think you should get more into Jesus than the elf. I think Jesus is better than the elf. Unconditional mercy. He's always good all the time. The elf is like reporting stuff back and forth to Santa. What's that about? Jesus is better than the elf on the shelf. And her exact response to me, I promise what she said. She looked at me and she said, real serious, I'm telling the elf you said that. It's amazing. I'm telling the elf you said that. Makes me so happy. So I was having fun with this. But I do believe that. I do believe the gospel is better news than karma, you know? That God is good to us, that God is gracious to us at our absolute worst, that we don't get what we deserve. That's a proclamation of the gospel. That's the message that God anoints. That's where I believe the power of the Holy Spirit will fall, is on people who will be unashamed and unafraid to recklessly preach the grace that's in that gospel. There's an anointing on that. That's a gospel that will be good news to the poor and to the poor in spirit. Everybody will receive from it. God's power will rest on people who proclaim that message in an extraordinary way. And I really believe that part of what's happening, again, kind of in the church, and it's always so squeamish to talk about judgment, but understand part of what I mean when I say this. Because I don't believe in a God who's an angry, punitive ogre. When I talk about judgment, I'm not talking about God just, all of a sudden, he's just so mad, he won't take it anymore, so now I'm going to unleash curses. I just believe, I believe that sin in general, anything that's kind of outside the will of God, and for me, it works like gravity. You know, Paul says the wages of sin is death. Like, there are certain consequences to actions. We reap what we sow. Now, the point we're talking about gospel being better than karma is that God is not the karma police who goes along, like, reinforcing this. God's job is he interrupts that cycle of cause and effect with grace. That's what God does. But that doesn't mean that principle still doesn't work, right? You know, like you jump off a tall building, you hit the ground. That's gravity. There are consequences. And so I believe, like, often what happens in terms of God's judgment is not that God just gets, he's so mad, he can't take it anymore. We just kind of get to the end of ourselves. We start reaping what we sow. And I think part of what's happening within the church right now is where there's places where legalism has been taught instead of gospel, or where there hasn't been a preference for the poor, where the gospel hasn't been good news for the poor, where the gospel hasn't been good news to immigrants and refugees, where the gospel hasn't been good news to people on the margins of society. Eventually, God just can't use that. There's no need for his power, so the power is not there. And I really believe that those wells in many ways are drying up and will continue to dry up. But for a people who's interested in being a church for the poor, who's interested in being a church for people on the margins for all kinds of reasons, who are interested in being a church that's full of grace and mercy, I believe there's a special power that's available to folks who are willing to live in that place. And here's the stuff where I can feel like really weird about talking the way that I do, because I grew up where people did lots, not only like was there the emphasis on miracles, but there were emphasis on like end times, and there were charts, and everything meant something. Everybody had like, they understood the end of the world, and you know, we always knew the Antichrist was. It was Gorbachev for a while, and it's Michael Jackson, it was Obama. It just kind of depends on where you live, but like it's always somebody, you know, whatever, whatever. And I got so suspect of those things. But you know, alongside of that, I also would hear all the end times preachers would talk about how not only would they talk about judgment, they would talk about the end times revival that's going to come. There's going to be this great revival in the last days, you know. And I remember one of those faith preachers, T.L. Lowry, and I can hear him doing this like in my head right now. I can really hear them. Brothers and sisters, the day is coming when those football stadiums are going to be filled with people who are getting filled up with the Holy Ghost. And Dan Rather is going to come out to cover it. And he's just going to fall out in the power. And he's going to start speaking in tongues on national television. And these are the kind of things he'd preach. Like, that day is coming. And like, man, that, you know, that sounds awesome to me. Like, I would love a revival that fills stadiums and people speak. Like that sounds great. I don't know whether or not that's what it's going to look like. I don't know. But I tell you what I do sense and believe these days, as odd as it makes me feel to say it. You know, it's like some of my coming full circle is I think that we are at such a unique point in history, which is not the same thing as saying Jesus is going to come back tomorrow. Maybe he will, but I'm not saying that. I do think a lot of those things were not given for us to know. I do sense that this is a real, I don't know, just a really pregnant sort of time, and this is a uniquely combustible kind of time where, along with all the volatile things that are happening in the world, surely there's something unique that God wants to do by his Spirit. The Spirit always, think again about Genesis, the Spirit hovers over the chaos. Where there is chaos, there's room for the Holy Spirit. Where there's chaos, there's room for something new. And as much as I'm freaked out by the chaos, and let me be clear, I'm freaked out. I have many days where I'm freaked out. The world right now freaks me out. And my dad is 70 years old, and we have lots of wonderful conversations about all kinds of things. We don't always see the world exactly the same way, but I've heard my dad say so many times to me in the last few weeks, we'll talk on the phone, Jonathan, I've just never seen our country the way it is right now. I've never seen it like this. The amount of division, like all of that is just true. I do believe that to be true. And that doesn't encourage me on its own merit. But what does encourage me is that when that much chaos is stirring up, it surely makes me think there's something particular that the Holy Spirit wants to do. Even when the Spirit is poured out on the day of Pentecost, remember that before people are wowed by it, they're bewildered by it. There's confusion first. We hear all these people speaking in other... What does this mean, you know? I just think that when there's chaos and disruption, it can make room for the Holy Spirit in a really particular way. And that's my hope for the church in general right now, is that the chaos will make us more open to the Holy Spirit in ways that we were not before. Will make us more open to what does God want to do in this moment, which is not the same thing as saying God's directly responsible for everything weird being stirred up. But even that, even within the things being stirred up, maybe there is a kind of judgment in that things are being illuminated. Things that have been in the darkness are being brought out into the light. Not so that God can punish, but so that God can heal. Racial tensions that are not new. You don't actually think that there's been like a sudden downturn in the last couple years, and now all of a sudden racism. Like, no, these are things, 400 years worth of demons that are really out in the open right now and need to be exercised. But it's been around for a long time. Some of us white middle class folks, we haven't been especially aware of it, but things that have always been, they're just being revealed. Stuff that was always under the surface, it's being revealed right now. And that's painful and it's hard, but I wonder if it doesn't make us more open for the Holy Spirit again. Because the fact of the matter is, I think a lot of us have been used to living in a place culturally, and I'm talking about all churches like in North America, no matter what your tradition. At the end of the day, things have been easy enough for us to where church will essentially work with or without the Holy Spirit. Franchise it, package it, be fine, do these four things, great, you know. Wouldn't know the difference if the Holy Spirit showed up or not. Because we haven't exactly needed the Holy Spirit, really. And that, I'm telling you, unique things happen in the kingdom of God when people get to a place where they're desperate. I just believe that. That Azusa Street revival I was talking about came out of desperation. The hillbilly Pentecostals in the mountains, that move of God came out of a place of desperation. When people really do get to the end of themselves and they're not okay anymore with kind of the status quo. Oh, it just, when the chaos gets stirred up, there's room for God to work in a new way. And I can't help but wonder if we're in that kind of moment right now. What happens if we get hungry for the Holy Spirit again? What happens if we're open again? What happens if we're needy and dependent again? Imagine this. What happens if it actually is going to take God actually going to take the Holy Spirit for what we do to work. Oh, could you imagine that? We need the Holy Spirit. We joke sometimes in my family, somebody asks for prayer. It's kind of just a running joke that someone will say, like, has it come to that? I do that sometimes with my dad. Like, I needed you to pray for me. Has it come to that? Just like, pray? What do you mean? We've been doing just fine without prayer. Who needs that? We're at a place right now, I just think the desperation creates an environment where there's just room for God to move in a way that's different. Last thing I want to say, I feel like I'm saying a lot of things, but this feels important to me to say today. Knowing that this is a church already that's founded on grace and mercy, that's what you care about, and I just feel it here. I'm aware that all people would be welcome here. You know, I can sense that there would be a spirit of hospitality and generosity. Like I get that. So there's no, I don't think I'm starting like from ground zero with any of that. But I also think, especially with the world changing as rapidly as it is right now, and all the things that are kind of in transition, and all the things that are kind of shifting in culture, I know that for many, even good people of God, who do essentially believe in a gospel of grace and mercy, and a God of grace and mercy, also, though, who are really freaked out about where the world is and where it's going, and are really freaked out about where the boundaries are, and really concerned about things getting too far this way or that way, and I get that. I get that there's a real kind of anxiety that happens and all that. That isn't just about, the scribes and Pharisees will always be with us, but not just people who are like fundamentally like have a religious spirit and they're mean or harsh or whatever. But like, no, but we care about what the Bible says and. What about this? And what about that? What about that text? And I love the grace and mercy stuff, but don't we need to balance that out over here? And I know John talks about Jesus being full of grace and truth. Interestingly enough, I feel like that expression in Greek seems to make it clear that the truth of Jesus comes out of the grace. It's very connected, but people talk about that like it's a seesaw. Like, you know, we need grace, so we need to make sure we have truth to balance it out. That's not how I see it, but I know a lot of people see that. Well, we got to have a certain amount of truth. And I understand, again, the anxiety around all of these things, especially when things are shifting so rapidly in culture. Here's the thing I keep thinking about, and I almost feel like this is two messages in one, but for me, this is all so connected. We were singing in worship, and this came to mind as something I haven't thought about. I can't remember when I've taught about this. Like, this is so, I don't know that I've ever exactly taught about this text, but I keep thinking about the parable that Jesus tells about the wheat and the tares. Do you remember that parable? About how, you know, when the farmer comes and he sows the seed, the wheat comes up, the wheat grows, but then the tares grow up as well. A really fascinating thing that Jesus says in this parable about the wheat and the tares. He says to let the wheat and the tares grow together. Let them grow together. And in the end, judgment comes. The tares will be separated from the wheat. There will be a fire. We could talk about what that fire means. Does that consume? Does that burn up? Or is it a purifying kind of fire? That might be another sermon for another time. The point of the parable, though, is that God is the one who will do this. God is the one who will separate the wheat and the tares. You can trust God to do God's job. Trouble with a lot of us is we don't want to let God do God's job. We want to do God's job. Hard to need God while you're playing God, and that's often what we end up doing, right? We feel the need to play God. So then we internalize all that anxiety because we're concerned. If we open the doors too wide, if we're too much about grace and mercy, it's too much of this stuff for the poor and whatever, but what if, what about this? What about that? What about these people? What about those people? And I just keep being drawn back to that image over and over again right now of this idea that, for one, if there is wheat growing in a Christian community, if God is moving, if the Spirit is moving, and disciples are being made, and good things are happening, if wheat is growing, tares will also grow. You don't get one without the other. That's a weird thing about growth, like in any kind. Like you can't just choose more of like the good. If you're open to more, you get more everything. Do you know what I'm saying? Like anytime I feel like God has blessed me in some way, right? Like, if from a ministry standpoint, if I feel like God gives me favor with a new group of people that I didn't know before, then along with that favor comes more criticism. Yeah. All at the same time. Yeah. here's more people who say, that message really touched me. Thank you for that. And here's more nasty emails, all at the same time, right? In the words from Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility. Anything in your life that has ever grown, if a business grows, as a relationship grows, and good things are happening, also more weight comes down with all of that. More, you know what I mean? Like, it just always grows at the same time. And I'm just convinced that a lot of us are living with way too much anxiety about all this because we're not willing to take our hands off and just say, let the wheat and the tares grow together. Let God do the sorting. Instead of us feeling like we need to be always be the ones who are on top of that. What if we're not just not supposed to be doing nearly as much sorting? I know that sounds scary for people. Because we're grace, you know, that grace stuff really can be abused. Absolutely can be abused. But, you know, here's the thing that I found over and over again in my own life and working with other people too. Man, I hope I have the grace to even say this the right way. If we do start living our lives in a way that is kind of outside of God's jurisdiction, like what would be God's best for us, at a certain point, life just stops working. Like, it just doesn't work. Gravity has its way at some point, you know? So you end up hitting the ground. And sometimes that has to happen. Sometimes that's important to happen, right? Like, you can't stop that from happening. But in my experience, over and over again, it's like, man, maybe if you're in a relationship where there's a lot of, where there's closeness and intimacy and openness, sometimes, you know, if someone's looking for counsel from somebody else, you know, that's kind of a different scenario. But unless you're invited into somebody else's life or space in that way, I'll just ask you the question, how much luck have you had trying to mess with it, get people to see the error of their ways? And like, man, I've seen over and over, you know, alcoholism is not a thing for me, but I've seen it over and over again, like maybe a handful of times where someone said to a friend, hey, I think this is an issue, pray about this, deal with it, and kind of gets headed off at the pass. But mostly what I've seen is if someone's far enough along in addiction, they're not going to listen to anybody else until they hit the bottom, and then they're ready for some kind of change. And if you try to force that prematurely, might push them away, but very rarely works. And I'm just getting to a place where more and more in my life, I'm just realizing, like, I'm not the Holy Spirit. I'm not God. Unless there's a special grace, again, to address something in context of relationship, most of that's just not given for me to do. Because people are actually going to do, to a point, what they're going to do. Probably not going to change their minds. What if we stop feeling the anxiety to even try? And it's like, okay, let's let the wheat and the tares grow together. And trust that God will be God. God will sort. I feel like some of that anxiety comes for some of us, especially when you're a person who's trying to do things the right way and kind of keep the rules. And there's this weird kind of like, well, man, I'm working hard to fight temptation. I'll be darned if somebody else is going to do it the wrong way and like be blessed. But see, that's the thing. If you're doing it the wrong way, you're not going to be blessed. To a certain point, gravity takes over. Judgment comes around in that way. See what I'm saying? Like, no one needs to enforce it. So, like, there's really no need for that. I just wonder, I feel like there's some things even in my own heart, you know? It's like, how many things in my life where I feel like I'll get so paralyzed because I overthink my own motives and I'm almost too interior in that way. I get so deep in my head and all that. But that essentially means I'm always trying to pull out the weeds. And I feel like increasingly I'm coming to places in my life where I feel like what the Holy Spirit's giving me is just sometimes you have to let the wheat and tares grow together. Keep being in the presence of God. Keep showing up. Keep praying. Keep being available. And God gives us the insight that we need when we need it. You know, He shows us what we need to see when we're ready to see it. But just not to live in constant anxiety about this. Because I really think it's impossible. Again, I'm saying a lot of things. I promise I'm landing with this. I think it's impossible to both have an open environment that's welcome for the power of the Holy Spirit, where the gospel is good news to the poor and there's grace that's flowing. You can't do that and be a people who are sorting wheat and tares at the same time. It just won't work. You choose one or the other. And I think, like, if we're willing to let God be God in that, to trust that if we're getting people in the presence of Jesus, He knows how to take good care of his kids. He knows how to correct when correction is needed. The Holy Spirit knows how to convict when conviction is needed. The Holy Spirit will do that. Some of us, I just think fundamentally, we just don't trust the Holy Spirit to do the Holy Spirit's job in that way. If we'll trust God to do that part, and what we'll proclaim is a gospel that's good news to the poor, that brings release, that brings freedom, God will take care of God's job. And I just think if we can embrace that, if we can embrace the truth of that, and we can just, and we'll just do our job, which is to welcome the poor, which is to welcome people who are marginalized in any and every sort of way, which is to declare God's freedom and love and grace and truth. Oh, what? Even where profound transformation is needed, have you ever seen anybody transformed? Where whatever was going on in their life was destructive, was it somehow like just loved out? I mean, have you ever seen it work any other way? I mean, I literally have not. What I find is that over and over again is that when people get to really broken places and they find out that God fully sees and knows them in that broken places and yet they're loved, that's where transformation can happen. That's where transformation does happen. It doesn't happen any other way. I just think some of us, we kind of see this as if, again, like if we don't do the sorting, if we don't do the judging, like it's somehow not going to, like it's not going to get done. If we try to do God's job, it will not work. We will not change anybody's mind. Some of this I'm struggling with right now in other ways, and I don't know what to do with it yet. These are just things I'm feeling, because I'm aware that like sometimes even things that I feel like God has given me to say that I feel like are good or useful or whatever, you can kind of end up preaching to the choir, and I think like, man, when have I ever convinced somebody of something on Facebook? You know what I'm saying? How many times does that happen? I mean, I don't use Facebook quite as much, but you know what I mean. I'm more of a Twitter person, but same thing. Somebody's open, if they're teachable, if they like what I'm doing already, and like they're open, that's kind of like one thing. But how often has it happened that I confronted someone about something and like, oh, the scales have just fallen off my eyes from that tweet. Now I'm here. Does that happen for you very often? I mean, it almost never happens to me. And I'm just seeing this whole principle over and over again, like in just my life. It happens like in families. Like, you know, you just try to take it, but take the bull by the horns, and you're just going to fix them. You're going to make it right. You just give that speech that you've been rehearsing in the shower. And I just ask you again, how well has that worked out before? Like, it doesn't change anything. It doesn't tend to make things better. So I'm trying to even discern that in many ways in my own life right now. What does it look like for me to be faithful to proclaim the things that God has called me to proclaim, and not to live with such anxiety all the time about the people who aren't there? But, well, how am I going to get them from there to here? Maybe I'm not supposed to get them from there to here. I've been given a job. I've been given a message. I have something I'm supposed to say and something I'm supposed to do. I will say that. I will do that. God is the one who provides the increase. God is the one who grows. God is the one who changes. Results are not up to me. I just wonder how much freedom and liberation could come for some of us. I have no idea how long I've been talking. You said y'all go 2 hours sometimes. Like, I promise I'm almost done. Y'all just, I feel the grace in the room to get, so like, it just, goodness, what would happen if we just let go of our need to control the results at all? That's totally up to God. If we have clarity on what our mission is, if we have clarity on our focus, oh, and here I'm not talking about mission statements and vision and values or whatever. I think that what we had today is a pretty good place to start. Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach the gospel to the poor, to preach freedom to the captive, sight to the blind, the year of God's favor, not the day of vengeance of our God. That's not our part. See that? That's not our part. That's God's job. God is the one who will judge. That's not part of our proclamation. God will take care of that part. So if we'll just do what we're called to do, to extend his love and grace, to preach his love and grace, to live out that love and grace in real life, God will do God's job. God will be faithful to do God's own work. God will give us the power of the Holy Spirit to proclaim this in grace and truth. And as when people are ready to see other things, then there'll be grace for that too. But in the meantime, it's just not our job to do. I, what I'm trying to do with this, if anything, is I just love for some of you to get to a place where, because again, I feel like some of us live in such constant anxiety. Oh, wouldn't it be great, especially with the world being in such chaos? Can you imagine how much happier and freer that we might become if we just didn't bear the pressure of that all the time? That's part of what I found in my life is it's just too much weight and pressure. The thing that I do is when someone hurts me, of trying to analyze their motives and what are they really setting out to do. Oh, it's just such anxiety and pressure. To be able to come to the Lord and say, you know, I know that that hurts and that feels bad. If someone feels like an enemy to me, like I'm going to bless them, but I'm not going to try to like figure them out. I'm not going to need to understand them. I'm not going to need to diagnose them. I spend so much time in my head like doing all these things, right? It doesn't bring the fruit of the Spirit. It doesn't bring peace. It doesn't bring joy. Nothing good comes out of any of that. Oh, all the armchair quarterbacking that we do about things that we can't change, you know? And as much as, and I feel like there's a tension here, of course, but I think there are ways that we're called to affect change in the world in ways that are constructive and meaningful. But I'm, you know, just learning that too, that sometimes when I'm kind of internalizing all the stuff that's going on out there, like it's my job to fix, like, man, it's just not, it's a really big world and I just can't fix it all. We're in a time where we're hit with such a constant stream of information that we can't do anything with. And it just gets in our heads. I don't know if he's going to hear this, and I'm getting nervous now if it's online because I love it so much, but I joke with my dad sometimes. I'm like, Dad, just need to not read Facebook late at night so long. Just get in a stew, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, ugh. I don't think we're supposed to bury our heads in the sand and ignore what's going on. That's not what I mean. But it's like if you just live in that all the time, it's a constant invitation to make judgments about everything and everybody. And it just doesn't help. Stand with me if you would, because I could just do this all day. I don't know if this has been interesting to you. It's been interesting for me because I was sort of like, I didn't know where any of that was going. It's just kind of, I want to take a moment to pray before we come to the Lord's table and just invite you just to close your eyes for a moment. And first of all, maybe even before we pray, just in a reverent posture, we've already worshiped today. We're so clearly in the presence of the Lord. I just want to just encourage you with these words. With all of my heart, I believe that in a unique and particular way, that the Holy Spirit is on this church and on these leaders. God is with you. God is for you. There's a unique witness that you have in this town that's so needed. God is here, and God has such good work for you to do. And I would even go so far as to say, while again, I'm not in a position to judge anything, I just so sense God's pleasure in the whole spirit of this house, the tenderness that's here, the humility that's here, the love that's here. That even when there's things that you have to really struggle with, that there's a desire to struggle through it together and to love one another through it, I believe that God is so pleased with that. And I believe precisely because this is a place that's humble and open, you're a people who is postured to uniquely receive a fresh outpouring of God's Holy Spirit that will be ready for that, to be used of God in that way. All he's looking for is availability. All he's looking for is openness. For people who are hungry and thirsty, you'll be filled. For people who want to be used by God, you'll be used. For people who want to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit is available to you. So God, I just ask you now to behold your sons and daughters here who've come, their hands open and their hearts open, learning how to live with their hands and hearts open to the world. They want to be used by you. They want to be a witness for your love and your grace and your beauty in this very fallen, very divided world. So God, unashamedly, I ask for a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit here at Life Center. That signs would follow those who believe. I pray for both the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit to grow here And even though this seems strange to pray, I do pray that the wheat and tares would grow up together. I pray, Lord, that you would just allow them to grow and expand in their hearts, in their minds, in their numbers. I pray for the grace here to not feel the need to sort it while it's still in the midst of growing in all those ways, but to trust you to be God. I would just invite you, if you feel comfortable in this, if you want a fresh outpouring of God's power and God's Spirit in your life, you want to be available in that way, would you? We just lift our hands together. And however you would want to say this, let's let our prayer in essence just simply be this in some form, out of your own heart, out of your own mouth, in your own words. Simply say now, come, Holy Spirit, come. We just invite your breath and your presence. We invite your healing. We invite your peace. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your power. Fill us with your grace. Fill us with your word. Lord, we so want to be used by you. And with no desire to work anything up or try to manipulate anything in this moment, Lord, I just so believe and I trust you, God, for such a powerful demonstration. Not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. God, I believe that you're breathing freshly into your people now. I believe that there is a stream of living water here. I believe, God, that there is healing and beauty in these waters here, Father, that's going to be poured out to the city, Lord, in a way that so many will receive. God, I just pray for us to be open and to be receptive. Let this be a place where your Spirit flows freely. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Neil had asked me if I would lead you guys to the table, which would be such an honor for me to do. I was just pulling up my liturgy here. I don't know how y'all normally do this, so feel free to do. You come forward with the elements first. Okay, great. That'd be awesome. I believe that the table of the Lord is so central to everything else that we do, because as we come and we receive the broken body of Christ, the shared, as we drink now of the cup, we also are going to be poured out in his name. I have my whole little liturgy here that I use, and some of this might not be helpful if we're not able to do it together. Let's just do it this way. God, I pray that in the same way that your body was broken and your blood was poured out, God, I pray now that in the reception of this meal and of these elements, that we would become the body of Christ, broken for the world. Somehow, Lord, that we would be, in our brokenness, that we would be distributive. That the love and the mercy and the grace that is here and in this place, God, would come out of us now. And that as we've been served by you, that we would go out and serve the world. Allow this to become, for us, the body and blood of Christ. Allow us to become the body of Christ. Be broken, to be poured out for the sake of the world. Grant it, Holy Spirit. And now I'll just speak this invitation that's become such a dear one to me, or at least a version of it as best as I can do it from memory. This table that's spread for you now, this table that's spread before you, this is a table that is not spread for the powerful, for the mighty. This is a table that's spread for the broken. It is only here for those who are hungry and those who are thirsty. The only qualification that you need to come to this table this morning is that you want God, that you want to know him more. So in those words that have become so dear to me, to those who have been here often and those who have not been here long, for those who have tried, for those who have failed, for all of those who want God more, this table is open for you. This is not the table of the church, but the table of the Lord. It is welcome to all who want to meet him here. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.